it please the court, counsel. My name is Michael Filipovich. I represent Schaefer Cox, along with my co-counsel, Ann Wagner, who's seated at counsel table to the left. I would like to reserve at least 5 minutes for rebuttal argument in this matter. I intend to address the issues concerning the convictions for conspiracy to murder federal officials or federal agents and the count in which Mr. Cox was convicted for solicitation to murder federal agents, as well as the jury instructions related to the conspiracy count. In the briefing, we address these issues primarily from the standpoint of the three, I would suggest, are three separate conspiracies that the government alleged. Conspiracy to kill or murder the fictitious federal hit team that they acknowledged didn't exist. Secondly, a conspiracy to murder people on a list that they allege was maintained by Cox and one of the other co-conspirators. And their third theory, which was this so-called 2-for-1 plan. For purposes of argument today, I think I'm going to approach it a little differently because I think federal jurisdiction, based on the language in the FIOLA case, which we both cite to, is so important, is really the first step the court has to address. I want to
approach you most in the hit team allegation, does it not?
I'm sorry, Your Honor?
FIOLA helps you most in the hit team claim, does it not?
Yes, absolutely. I mean, FIOLA says where the object of the intended attack is not identified with sufficient specificity so as to give rise to the conclusion that had the attack been carried out, the victim would have been a federal officer. It doesn't say could have been or may have been a federal officer. Then it's impossible to assert that the mere act of the agreement poses a sufficient threat to federal personnel and functions so as to give rise to federal jurisdiction. We simply don't have that here with this fictitious hit team. And a couple of points on that. The government conceded, I mean more than conceded, in the indictment, they described this federal hit team as fictitious. They acknowledged that in the jury instructions they submitted with respect that it went to the jury on the overt acts. And finally, in closing, they never challenged the fact that this was a figment of someone's imagination.
So what exactly is the problem? You can have a conspiracy that's impossible to accomplish and still have a conviction for conspiracy.
Well, this is not a question of impossibility. This is more of a question on this point. It has to do with whether you can establish federal jurisdiction. The Supreme Court spoke to that problem in FIOLA. They say if you don't have a specifically identified target, and you don't here, you have...
You do. It just it didn't really exist. But in the minds of the people that were involved, they anticipated a federal hit team. And the federal part was part of that.
Well, the way the government argued it, there was not a risk. There was a minimal risk, if any, and probably no risk to federal agents. When he argued, Mr. Scrocchi argued this in closing to the jury, he said something bad could have happened, and he tied it to state troopers perhaps showing up at KGNP on this private property and maybe something going sideways. So with respect to this fictitious hit team, it's a matter of legal inadequacy, not factual impossibility.
Well, and counsel, let's suppose for the sake of the discussion that you're correct about the hit team piece of the conspiracy. There are other portions of the conspiracy that were demonstrated. So how would, in your view, a successful argument about the fictitious hit team affect the remainder of the case?
Well, first, with respect to the solicitation count, I know the government in their answer to the bill of particulars gave three possible targets. In closing, all they argued on the solicitation was the fictitious hit team. They didn't argue the other two theories.
That's true. I guess my question was more geared towards the conspiracy count.
Well, Your Honor, with respect to the conspiracy count, if the other two theories, and I'll address the other two theories in a moment, could even get to the or should have gotten to the jury, then we have a serious problem in terms of unanimity of the jury verdict, because this is not a case of just mere factual insufficiency. This is a case of legal inadequacy. And I think
it,
under
it depends on whether you view it as a single conspiracy with a bunch of potential means or overt acts or as separate conspiracies. But if it's a single conspiracy with a bunch of subparts, I guess I have difficulty seeing for the conspiracy charge why that would negate the remainder.
Well, Your Honor, I would respectfully suggest that there were actually three separate agreements here tied to different events, and some of them actually involved different participants. So with respect to the fictitious hit team, that was addressed specifically. It was an agreement to act in self-defense to repel an assassination team.
If we were to disagree with your view that it was three separate conspiracies or three separate agreements, what would your answer to my question?
Well, I think the answer would be that there were still different objects within this conspiracy, even if the court concluded this were some overarching conspiracy. But first, this was not an overarching conspiracy just to kill federal agents willy-nilly, whoever might show up. The government alleged this in the response to the Bill of Particulars and how they tried the case as three essentially finite objects that they were addressing. And I think the jury would need to be, our position under LaPierre and other cases, there needs to be unanimity on at least one of those, and we have to have some confidence that all of the jurors agreed on one. It's not just, and if you throw one out, then you can't have that confidence.
Under Shad versus Arizona, why do we have to focus on objects? Why can't it be the means of carrying out the conspiracy?
Well, Your Honor, if you focus on the means here are, I'm not sure I quite understand the court's question.
You're saying there has to be a unanimity instruction, okay?
Yes.
And if you have to indicate who the objects are, I understand your point. My question is, under Supreme Court law, conspiracy law, isn't it adequate for the government to speak of the means of the conspiracy and not necessarily the object, particularly when, as my colleague mentioned, the allegation is that there were various ends in mind?
Well, I think the place where I would have to draw the line or disagree is that there was one overarching conspiracy with a single object, and this was multiple.
Right, I know that's your position, but I'm just saying if you look at this as a series of conspiracies with certain means in mind, isn't that sufficient under conspiracy law to uphold not the hit person concept, which we've talked about before, but rather some of the other allegations?
Your Honor, I'm reluctant to concede that point absent...
I'm not surprised.
So let me segue to the other identified federal actors in this case. The easy one is Jimmy Johnson, the U.S. Marshal. The government lists him as an identifiable federal victim in this case for purposes of the solicitation count. They didn't argue it. There's no evidence whatsoever that my client or anybody else, or that my client directed someone to kill or do any harm to Jimmy Johnson. They had no history together. There was no reason, and that's probably why the government didn't argue that. The other identified federal actors are the three individuals who work either for the Department of Homeland Security or TSA, who Mr. Cox asked to be put on a list, but were never put on a database, the database that Mr. Anderson maintained. There's an exhibit in the record, a yellow pad, where their names are listed. No addresses were discovered. So nothing. There was no follow up there. But with respect to the conspiracy, the salient point is the evidence is simply not in the record that there was an agreement combined with the mens rea for murder to kill these three individuals. What the evidence established was that these individuals names were given by Mr. Cox to Mr. Anderson, presumably to perhaps do some research on where they lived, although that was never never done, with the idea that they, among a number of other both state and federal actors, might be people that if the government, our government, fell apart, we ended up in Stalin-esque martial law. And if these individuals participated in Stalin-esque martial law by rounding people up, putting people in the gulag, then if we have to defend ourselves to this Stalinist martial law, then they might be people.
Does it matter to our analysis whether the conditions precedent are reasonably likely to occur or are not likely to occur? That is, are there, well, I guess I'm just wondering whether it's different to say we will commit this violence if the sun comes up tomorrow, but if it doesn't, we're fine. Or in other words, does their view have to be objectively reasonable? Does that matter?
Well, I think it does matter, but I think there's a more basic question, and that is whether there was ever an agreement to kill these folks with premeditation and with malice aforethought on these facts, which I think is a different question.
Yeah, but I guess what concerns me is does it matter if these conditions are unlikely to ever occur?
Well, I think it should matter. The conspiracy law, you can't have a conspiracy law that's conviction where it's a contingent on some other concrete facts. We've cited those cases in our briefs. We've articulated where we believe the line is. But I think if the...
Is Viander one of the cases that you cite?
Your Honor, I don't recall off the top of my head if that was the name of one of the cases. I see that I'm running out of time here. I would like to reserve some time for rebuttal.
That.
May it please the court, counsel. Stephen Scrocky for the U.S. Attorney's Office. I was lead counsel on the trial of Mr. Cox. I apologize for the weather this morning. I wish it was better for you.
It's all your fault.
You can't control the weather? Come on.
No, we cannot, sir.
But the government could do everything.
I guess we'll see. Your Honors, with respect to the questions that you asked defense counsel, the primary issue here is not foreseeability of whether martial law would have occurred, or a Stalin-esque Solzhenitsyn-type martial law would have occurred. It's what Mr. Cox thought was going to happen. What he thought was going to happen in here, which was evidenced by the trial in this case, he had a list that was a checklist of acts of war by the government. And that checklist included martial law. And that checklist included 13 out of 15 things that he thought was going to happen. And it's critical for the court to understand, because there's a lot of static in this case, where both parties are going back and forth about what this means, what that means. What's critical for the court to understand, and I would direct you to Mr. Cox's testimony at trial. He sat in that box for 3 days and told the jury everything that's in this brief, and they discounted it. What he thought was going to happen was he was going to get arrested. This case involves a movement. Within that movement is a conspiracy. Mr. Cox controlled the militia. Mr. Cox controlled the timing. And by not showing up to state court to face state charges on a lawful possession count, he triggered the event which was going to trigger the two-for-one. We're going to kill two law enforcement officers or judges or federal officials for every one of us that's taken or kidnapped. And that came right on him. He owned that.
Counsel,
yes, sir.
I appreciate the overall view, but let's focus for a moment on the solicitation count. Isn't your opponent correct that under FIOLA, the solicitation to commit murder just doesn't fly?
I think that Your Honor's comment, if you look at it in terms of a conspiracy and an agreement, and we keep that contained, what did they agree to do? What did Mr. Cox solicit his members to do? And Mr. Filipovich is not correct. These are the same people involved in the solicitation.
You're aligning two things, though, in your comment that you just made. The elements of solicitation are not the same as the elements of conspiracy. So there can be a conspiracy to murder without proving a solicitation to murder.
But in this case, we assert that there was a definite solicitation to commit murder. Mr. Cox had a meeting with all of the same people who were involved later on in the two-for-one plan to solicit the murder of federal officials. The fact that they did not show up and could not show up because they were fictitious, I don't think is relevant to the analysis. It could have been that
you're
a federal...
wrong about that. If they had to be solicited to murder an actual human being and the fictitious doesn't count, is there an alternative under the evidence as it came in that would support the solicitation count?
The alternative would be, we believe, the weight of the evidence to show the solicitation and the intent.
What does that mean? What specific evidence that has nothing to... I want you to leave aside the fictitious people.
Maybe you can rephrase your question for me, Your Honor.
Well, if soliciting someone to kill someone who doesn't exist isn't sufficient...
Under FIOLA.
Under FIOLA, under whatever, if that is not enough, what other evidence is there of solicitation specifically?
We would rely on the facts that Mr. Cox had a briefing with his militia team in order to discuss the murder of any federal officials or any federal officers that would show up to the KGNP security detail. And the facts, as proven by the whiteboard analysis that we put in our brief, that the statements of Mr. Olson, that if these individuals showed up, they were to be killed, and they would be stomped through the ice, and nobody would miss them. So there are numerous facts.
Which individuals are these?
They would be federal officials. And to be clear on the record, and to be totally clear, the directive was, if it's a local or a state, we're not going to do that. Don't shoot. But if it's a federal and they pull their guns, shoot them. Karen Vernon's notes taken from her house during the course of the search said, use grenades to stop.
I really struggle with whether there's a sufficient amount of evidence on this solicitation count. I really do. I really struggle with that. What's your best argument that on that count there is sufficient evidence?
That the court should examine the what we call the whiteboards, that one was taken out of Mr. Cox's home, which he wrote himself, which listed out what the participants were supposed to do at KGNP on that evening. And that was to, everybody's going to carry weapons, bring your hornet's nests, bring your guns, body armor, etc. Corroborating evidence from Lonnie Vernon's house when his house was searched, the same set of instructions. Coleman Barney's house was searched, the same set of instructions. They actually physically went out and did the security perimeter and the detail, stopped a private citizen, wouldn't let them proceed through the complex, and were directed and instructed to kill any federal officer who showed up. Now, practically...
I get your point about some of the other aspects of the conspiracy, but can you cite me or the panel to any case that have facts analogous to this on the solicitation to commit murder?
I think if we would have found it, we would have provided it to you, Your Honor.
Exactly. There isn't any such case, is there?
No.
So you're effectively asking us either to make new law or conclude there's not sufficient evidence on this point, right?
We would urge that the evidence was sufficient on solicitation, and that because it is so clear, this is not a situation of them making this up out of whole cloth. There was a direct intention for them to do that. There was no doubt about it. And if you...
Suppose I have a direct intention to kill Mickey Mouse, and I go solicit somebody to kill Mickey Mouse. Well, there's no Mickey Mouse to kill. Can you still have a solicitation? You can have a conspiracy that's impossible. Can you have a solicitation that's impossible?
I haven't found a case that says you can.
I mean, that's what I keep running up against. It seems so hypothetical, but...
But the point is maybe the difference between Mickey Mouse and a federal officer is there are federal officers and they exist and they are real.
Well, and I can understand why a conspiracy claim, because once you've launched a conspiracy, there is risk emanating from that. But solicitation suggests you've got a specific target, and if there is no real target there, isn't that a problem?
Your Honor, I don't think it takes it that far. I don't think it takes it that far that you need to have a real specific target. And I'm doing this by analogy that in the argument I made to Judge Bryan, Judge Bryan sat in this case for 5 weeks, 6 weeks, was that, again, I have to return to the conspiracy aspect of it. If you wanted to conspire to remove a nuclear weapon from an arsenal, this is exactly what I told him, it's a physical impossibility, most likely. You can get your bolt cutters, you can get a map, you can do all the things you want to do. And if it's a violation of federal law, you've conspired to do it. That doesn't mean it's not relevant and logical under the law. If it was Mickey Mouse, I would say you would have some grounds to be skeptical. But this was, and this may be a difficult decision for you, I can tell that. But you've got a specific identifiable body of people.
I have a practical question about this. If we were to disagree with the government's position about solicitation, would there be any need to remand for resentencing if we upheld the conspiracy conviction? And I say that because I think the sentences were to run concurrently.
That's correct. My understanding is they were to run concurrently. I have not made that examination, Your Honor, so I would not be able to answer that question for you.
Okay.
I apologize. I want to talk about the sufficiency of the evidence that Mr. Filipovich mentioned. And I want to point to really two exhibits which are really crystallize this entire case. And again, urge the court to, in the briefing, appellant asked the court really to focus on the beginning and the aspects of what happened in the beginning of this case. The court needs to look at the whole thing all the way up to the end, because the important part is this is what Mr. Cox really wanted. This is the hit list, as we call it, that Mike Anderson drew. And it's Exhibit 504 from the trial, SER 7, page 1579. Mr. Cox, and this is where... I'm sorry?
SER what?
Number 7 at page 1571, Your Honor. So SER 7, page 1571. This happened in the fall of 2009, and there's things in the briefing that state that it just had state people on it, but there are federal people here, and there's also a map of the Fairbanks federal office. And Mr. Cox talked to Mr. Anderson. He testified the jury heard all this. I need the names of federal marshals. I want some paperwork from the Vernons. And he lists three federal employees on this piece of paper. And why is this important? It's important because later on, Mr. Anderson testified, I added one more name to the list. And that was Marshal Jimmy Johnson, right here. And the important thing about that is it says federal hit list. It doesn't say come to coffee list or I want to talk to these people. It says federal hit list. And hit list means something. This is at ER 620. That's Exhibit 506 from the trial. And you have to, when looking at this issue, you have to also fold into Mr. Cox's own statements and what was found on his phone. They found the phrase hit list on his phone. He testified. Hit list meant a music list. I was going to make a music list. He testified he wasn't interested in grenades. He completely contradicted everything that was recorded by the government in the undercover recordings on the day he was arrested. But the most important thing is that at SCR 1605, Mr. Cox writes a press release that he's going to issue, and he essentially calls out the FBI and the U.S. Marshals. If you come to get me, this is what's going to happen to you and your followers. And when you combine that with this and U.S. Marshals and the name of Jimmy Johnson, it's irrefutable.
Let's say you're right on the conspiracy points. That we still get back to this issue of solicitation. All you have said doesn't really change the FIOLA analysis and the sufficiency of the evidence on the solicitation count, does it?
As a matter of law, it does not.
Okay.
I will concede that, Your Honor. So when you look at these, there is a mountain of evidence here, and a lot of times both parties are pointing different ways, different directions about what it really means. But the point of the matter is, what did Mr. Cox know, what did he think, and what did he do? And with respect to this list, at the end of the conspiracy, when Mr. Cox is running from the law and he's undercover, he doesn't want to get arrested, and he's been telling his friends that when I get arrested, two for one's going to happen. He wants this list. Why? When we know he wants that list, because he tells J.R. Olson to get it. Olson calls Anderson. Then he sends the Vernons to go get it. The Vernons want the list even independent of Mr. Anderson. They want the list. And why do they want the list? Because Mr. Cox is coming back to do guerrilla warfare. He tries to get the list to Mr. Anderson. He can't find him. He actually gets Coleman Barney, and they track him down, and then Mr. Cox finds out the list doesn't exist. But what's important in his mind at the time is that this database, which he says in the record, unrecorded conversation. It has everybody's name in it. And what's going to happen is when he's arrested, that is going to trigger the two-for-one plan. And that's irrefutable. The evidence is clear that he wanted this thing, and he wanted it bad because he knew what was going to be in it. And it's true, there's state people on here, but if you look at the record, Mr. Cox instructed Mr. Anderson time and time again, anybody who gets in his way or he's upset with, whether it's an Office of Child Services worker or somebody he bumps into at the airport who works for TSA just doing their job, makes the list. And why is that important? It's important because Mr. Cox was the only one, except for Mr. Anderson, his co-conspirator putting Jimmy Johnson's name on here, who decided who was going to make this list and who his people were going to kill. And that's why that's important. So I urge the court, I have 2 minutes left, actually a minute 30, I urge the court to pay attention to Mr. Cox's testimony and the outright fallacies that he testified to during the trial, to pay attention to Agent Sutherland's interview of Mr. Cox, where Mr. Cox denied talking to Mr. Anderson, denied providing names to Mr. Anderson, and denied really any unlawful conduct. And the jury was entitled to weigh that evidence under the sufficiency of the evidence. They were entitled to weigh that as to credibility and found him completely not credible, obviously. If you have any further questions, Your Honors.
I don't believe that we do. Thank
you for your time.
And Mr. Filipovich, you have some rebuttal time remaining.
I would like to focus on the conspiracy case. First, what this is really about is not what was in Mr. Cox's mind so much as whether there was an agreement with the proper mental state for the underlying crime of murdering federal agents. That's the key question, not what was in Mr. Cox's mind, although that may be relevant. With respect to a number of the factual representations made by the government, I would urge the court to carefully review the transcripts of some of these undercover tapes that the government is referring to. I would respectfully suggest, and as we've argued in our reply brief, the government is overstating and misstating the evidence in several key respects. Just now, with respect to Mr. Cox wanting that list towards the end, it was Mr. Olson at the direction of the FBI that was wanting the list and went to Mr. Cox. And FBI, of course, wanted this list because they were concerned. It didn't come from Mr. Cox. That came from Mr. Olson from the FBI.
What was the list supposed to be?
This list was begun sometime earlier with Mr. Anderson and Mr. Cox when they were having these discussions about the government at some point is going to fall apart. We may end up in a Stalin-esque situation in the United States where they're just rounding people up and our government collapses, and we believe that this may happen, and we need to prepare for that. And the list, according to Anderson's testimony, I urge the court to read Anderson's testimony, the government's witness, the people who are on the database with the addresses were all state officials. There were no federal officials on that list. The government holds up this...
You haven't actually answered Judge Clifton's question, and I would appreciate an answer.
I apologize.
Also, what was the point of the handwritten list that included the names of federal officials on it?
Well, the point of that, based on the testimony from Mr. Anderson, as I understood it, was at some point in the future there may be a Stalin-esque martial law in this country, and we want to have a list of individuals that, if those individuals who are officials of the government, state or federal, and these were three names that were given by Mr. Cox to Mr. Anderson. Anderson didn't act on it.
I single out those people. I mean, there are lots of federal officers, and if there was the Stalinist takeover, presumably there'd be people actively involved in that. But for some reason, these people were listed, and I can't figure out why.
Your Honor, it is difficult to understand, other than the fact that Mr. Cox actually knew them by name. He's in Fairbanks, and these are three federal officials that he's engaged with. I think he had some words with all three of them, but nothing from the testimony. There was not a long-seated dispute with them. They had done nothing wrong to him. He was not really angry at them. They were added because they were federal officials, and at some point in the future, if we have Stalin-esque law, and this is the evidence from Mr. Anderson, and if they participate in it, and we have to defend ourselves, unlike the innocent Russian citizens, then one of them or more of them may have to go. That I would respectfully suggest to the court, is not in agreement with premeditation and malice aforethought to kill any one of these individuals. I think that's just... was uncontroverted about that. That's what Anderson testified. There was a great deal of testimony about the fact that those folks had to participate. This was not just Cox and others were going to go round up federal officials and go ahead and kill them. The final thing is, in terms of federal hit list, those words were written by Mr. Anderson. They were not in his database. They were not on the yellow pad when he was taking notes, presumably based on what Mr. Cox was telling him. They were in a private field manual, and that was the only thing that was written, and he testified that it was his idea to put it under the name federal hit list, and it was his idea to add Jimmy Johnson to that field manual, and that was the gist of it. If I may just indulge the court for one more moment on the 241 issue, the 241 was primarily, almost exclusively, about state officials and his dispute with OCS. And secondly, 241 was not, if 241 starts, we kill people. It was a proportionate response. So if I get arrested, we arrest other people, which would not be sufficient for a conspiracy to murder. And again, I would urge the court to carefully review the testimony and those transcripts of those undercover meetings, because I think there's a big difference of opinion between the government and the defense on what was said, not on the inferences to be drawn, but actually what was said and what the evidence was.
Thank you, counsel. The case just argued is submitted. We appreciate very much the helpful comments from both of you, and we will take about a 10-minute recess.